inaugural Teacher Appreciation Night and first sort of attempt at providing a platform for teacher fellows and teachers that Intuit works with to reflect on their experiences with working with outsider art. This is something that we have, there's been a lot of conversation at Intuit around how to treat the educational programming or the educational side of what we do with the same sort of programming and attention that we do to some of our more traditional exhibition related content at Intuit. So we really appreciate you being here for this first attempt, and this is something that we look to expand and grow. And we really thank our panelists for offering to participate in this first conversation around using outsider art as a catalyst over this past school year. So with that, I think I'll start off by introducing myself. I think most of you in the room know who I am, but we have some new faces with us tonight. So my name is Melissa Smith, and I'm the Senior Manager of Learning and Engagement here at Intuit. And I would be remiss if I also don't point out my partner in crime, Jane Castro, School and Youth Programs Coordinator here at Intuit. Jane and I comprise the education staff here at Intuit. And to my left is another important, very important part of Intuit's education.
That's debatable.
No, not debatable at all. Jerry Steffel, our education committee board chair, co-chair, and long champion of outsider art in education in and around Chicago and nationally. I'll let Jerry maybe speak a little bit about himself.
Well, I just retired from the Art Institute after 48 years, so that was a milestone. And I also taught concurrently at Carl Sandburg High School in Orland Park, and just came back from the Advanced Placement Studio Art Reading for 2 weeks for 68,000 portfolios.
Oh, wow.
And we finished early.
Wow.
So, that's enough.
But Jerry has long been, of course, a facilitator and leader of the Teacher Fellowship Program, which is a big part of what we do here at Intuit for 20 more years or so. So Jerry has been my leader and guide for my 4+ years of being here as a staff. I come to Intuit as a former high school teacher myself. So it is very, it's very important and satisfying for me to be able to be in this role where I can still work with teachers and go into schools, but in a different capacity. So with that, introducing our panelists for tonight, we'll go from left to right. We have Rhonda Golson from Hyde Park Academy High School, visual arts teacher. Yay! And we have Erin Lynch from Yon School of Fine Arts, visual arts teacher. And from Peace and Education Coalition High School Sinclair Campus, we have Jordan Grimes, visual arts teacher. And we have Jennifer Christensen, ELA teacher at Skinner West Elementary School. And of course, we have lots of fellow partner teachers in the audience too. So even though these panelists are representing our conversation in a more seated, formal capacity, this is informal. We want everyone to chime in. Anyone who has worked past or currently or presently in the program throughout, we want you to kind of call in response and engage in some of the conversation, and there will be time at the end for question and answers and further insight as well. Jerry is going to speak a little bit about the history of the program and sort of set the tone for the conversation that we're going to have with the teachers.
Okay. The Teacher Fellowship Program has been going on at Intuit before we even had this building. We were at the Roger Brown Study Collection for a few years, exhibiting there. So I would say we're a good 25, 27 years that this program has actually been running. We started out, I think it was 5 or 6 schools, then it went to 10. This year we had 13 schools, so it's rather exciting to see the program grow like that. And I know a lot of our funders would like to see it grow even further, but because of staff and commitment time, it's just almost impossible to be able to do that. We have taken the teachers on field trips all over Chicago, Iowa, Wisconsin, different venues in Wisconsin. So it changes every year to different venues that are having various shows for self-taught art and focusing on that venue. This year, we wanted to create a packet that went along with the Chicago Calling exhibition that came down in February that I think everybody just about had seen. So the teachers were all asked to select one or two of the artists, of the 10 artists that were in that collection, write curriculum so we could put a package together, and that's just about finished, getting ready to go to Paris, where the show is right now at Hall St. Pierre. Rich has seen that. It's then moving on to Munich. In the spring of 2020, it goes to the Collection Layard Brut in Lausanne, Switzerland, Du Buffet's museum. And it ends up in fall of 2020 in Amsterdam at the Hermitage Outsider Museum. There's three museums in the Hermitage, which is really quite exciting. So we're thrilled that this packet is going to go on and kind of live on for a while. In fact, Charlotte Zander's museum in Bonnheim, Germany, I had given them a packet of lesson plans, and they were cataloging everything. And Eric Hill from Lincoln Park High School, they wanted to know about his lesson plan and where he was teaching now, because they were highlighting that in a school in Germany. So the legacy really does move on, which is very exciting. Mm-hmm. So that's just a brief history of what we've done.
Yeah, and the curriculum kit that will be comprised by the teacher lesson plans created this year is indicative of what Intuit is striving towards. There are some capacity and bandwidth issues that prevent us from getting these curriculum projects done as quickly as we would like, but we are working towards developing this Chicago Calling kit, as well as getting a backlog of lesson plans that have been created through the Teacher Fellowship Program posted to our website, so that Intuit can increasingly become a resource for lesson plans, teaching resources around outsider art for everyone to have accessibility to really be able to seek this out and utilize it in their classrooms. So we are chipping away at it. We have a wonderful education intern that is going to help us make progress towards that this year. So we have lots of summer projects on the horizon. We will keep you posted. But I think everyone almost in this room is familiar with the actual structure of the teacher fellowship program that we keep referencing. But for those of you who may not be, or those who may be seeing the videotape of this that aren't familiar, the Teacher Fellowship Program is a year-long professional development program that supports teaching pairs coming from schools in Chicago public school system, an arts teacher typically and a non-arts teacher working on a lesson plan together in their classroom after being exposed and engaged with their own learning about outsider art, developing an arts integrative lesson plan that they will implement in their classroom. And Intuit provides resources and support and feedback throughout that process. And students come and take a field trip to Intuit and are personally exposed and engaged to the art. And of course, it culminates in the wonderful exhibition that is presented every year at the end of the school year, which is on view right now. If there's anyone in this room who hasn't stepped back into the gallery yet to go see it, please do so before you leave, because we've been receiving wonderful feedback while the show has been up, that it is one of the strongest teacher fellowship program shows that has been presented here, because we've had such a strong cohort of teachers this year and a large number of schools participating this year. So that's just a little bit of a background around the program. We provide stipend for art materials and resources for participating teachers, and teachers also, of course, receive CPDU credits for their teaching license through the program.
And we have good lunches.
Yes, we have good lunches, we have good vibes, we have good people. Our sessions are really, really special. Sometimes it feels like a lot going on, but when you step back and reflect, our time together is always really fun and important. So if there's anyone in the room that hasn't participated in the program yet, I hope we're selling it well to you. So that's sort of a nutshell about where the work and where our discussion is coming from tonight. So with that, we're going to start by giving the floor to our panelists, maybe kind of going down the line, and we have some images to support what they'll be talking about, but each teacher is going to speak briefly about giving an idea of what the project they implemented throughout the school year, having been in the program, what it was inspired by, which artists they were looking at, just kind of a summary about what they did, and then we'll dive a little deeper into the reflections about the process. But just so everyone knows what the project and the pieces were. So first off, we have, ooh, I see there's an icon here. We have Hyde Park Academy High School. So Rhonda, if you'd like to tell us a little bit, sorry, I don't know what this pop-up is. A little bit about your project and the work that you implemented in your classroom.
Okay. Our project was inspired by Joseph Yocum and Skelis, and we also picked a third Chicago self-taught artist named Bruce Rocket. And what we did was we came up with a political stance, actually. So it, around the school area, the Obama Library or Presidential Center is going to be built, and there's a lot of you know, things in the news about the lawsuit, and they really don't want it there, and it's taken away from the natural resources or natural land in the area, and it's a private organization. So we decided to, our theme was defiance of the mainstream, and what does that look like? And when people take land and do something with it, is it something positive or is it something negative? Skelis and Yocum would do amazing landscapes. So Bruce Riley does this poured paint. We had the students do a poured paint background and then really study the style of Yocum and Skelis, and also look at Jackson Park as inspiration to, like, what the memories of what it looks like now as opposed to what it will look like in the next 2 years. And so over the poured paint background, they created these landscapes. And some were from their inspiration from Jackson Park, and some were actually from their memories of what a landscape actually looks like, because they weren't looking at anything specifically. It was all from memory. And we came up with those pieces. We had, I used three of my freshman classes, and the other teacher used two or three of her classes, one junior class, and then some freshmen were involved as well. So juniors and freshmen created the artwork.
And Tina is here, fellow teacher.
And how did the students like it?
The students really liked it. They really liked the poured paint because it was something that they had never experienced before. And the way that we had to go about pouring the paint. And I think the hardest part was maybe pulling a landscape out of them. Because when they were looking at the poured paint, like, they didn't necessarily see sky. They saw aerial views of things. So the sky wasn't really present, and they had to push themselves to see, like, where can the horizon line go and how can I add this? Looking at, and we did take images when we came on the field trip to the Intuit Museum. We stopped in Jackson Park to take images of what the park looks like. So I had those images available for them to use as inspiration as well.
I just saw this morning an update about that the development's going to proceed.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I was really thinking about this and how ironic it was that that development came right when we were going to be talking about this.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, Rhonda, for that summary. Next, we have Erin, who's going to speak about the project at Yonge.
So I'm the visual arts teacher at Yonge School. I did this unit in congruence with my third grade classroom teacher, and together we called our project Landmarks of Our Lives. So we had a really interesting situation in our school that it's very diverse. There's a lot of gentrification, so there's a lot of change up and kind of racial issues, socioeconomic issues. The school had been really focused on a full inclusion model and is changing a little bit, but we have a very large population of students with special needs. So kind of coming into this, we really wanted to focus on how we could allow all our students kind of unifying together. And we thought about working with our community. So we were influenced by the artist Aldo Brando Piacenza, who has these spectacular birdhouses that are created of landmarks from his history back in Italy, some from memories, some from pictures, but talking, you know, we came up with the concept that they were landmarks because they were places that were pinnacles, churches that were the centerpiece of some type of neighborhood. They might not be a landmark to someone far away, but it was a piece of importance in his life. So we had pushed our students to think about what was a landmark that they could come up with in their community. So I had a student who had the corner store, another student who has a clock tower that they used to hang out with their family. Another one was, my dad and I go to the Hancock Building. So, you know, some of them were related to actual landmarks, but some of them were very hyper-local locations. So then they were pushed to also be inspired by both the artist Wesley Willis and Mr. Imagination. These are third graders, mind you. So, you know, we wanted to connect with that piece that outsider art oftentimes has intense repetition. So they had to come up with some symbol to represent their landmark. So they weren't building necessarily a model to a T of what their landmark was. They could have abstraction. We talked about the difference between abstracted symbols or representational symbols. Played around and practiced with that quite a bit because, again, these are third graders and that's difficult even for some of our older students, but they really surprised us in coming up with a repetition of this one's a TV, repeating some type of symbol. That's a place where he and his family gather and sit, but this is the screen. And I know he had so much difficulty like in cutting it and things breaking and there were some tears, but it came together on this. The second component was the writing piece where they wrote narratives about how and why these places were landmarks in their lives and should be considered that in their communities.
Great. Thank you. And next we have Jordan Grimes from Peace and Education.
Yep. Thank you. So we did Henry Darger. And our project is called In the Realms of the Real, to contrast his In the Realms of the Unreal. So his imaginary Vivian Girls, we wanted to base it off of something really real. Working with a social studies teacher, we kind of just did a popcorn call and response about what kind of story we would want to have. Started off with the character, what happens to the character if somebody shouted out that, baby was born was, you know, baby was taken away, BCFS, what happens next. So the story just really developed really naturally, which was really nice for the students. Then we kind of just, you know, had them pick out a scene that they were most interested in. And then like Darger did, we created one set of the image of the boy and the girl, who were the main characters, like the Vivian girls, and had them reproduced throughout each image. And I guess that's kind of the gist of it. It goes on from there in terms of like how they created their boxes and everything and the materials we used, but
yeah,
it's kind of a summary of the project.
Great. Yeah, and we'll definitely break some of that down a little more. And I do apologize, these beautiful pieces are very hard to photograph, so I know that these are maybe not the best representations of what's actually conveyed in the pieces, but go see them in the back gallery and look close. Okay, and Jennifer from Skinner West.
Yeah. Hi, everybody.
Yes, Jennifer.
So I teach 7th grade at Skinner West. I teach ELA, so I worked in collaboration with Jackie, who's here. She's our fantastic art teacher. So the project we did was based around a unit I had already started on identity, something that 7th graders are very, you know, very prevalent in their lives, figuring out who they are. So we talked about the different elements of identity in my classroom, read literature about the Hate U Give, and talked a lot about stereotypes and bias, and so they had a really nice foundation prior to heading into this unit. So Jackie and I decided to really focus on the idea of symbolism as a way to integrate language arts with the artwork. We focused on the artists Vanessa German and Mr. Imagination. They were our inspiration. So in my class, the students had to identify an element of their identity that they were most, that was most prevalent in their lives at that point in time. And from there, they wrote their identity trait on a little slip of paper, and then after that, the students had to jot biases that they had or that they've heard about that particular trait. And from there, the students wrote I am statements about these biases, very strong I am statements. And from those statements, they had to write 10 of them. And then from each of those statements, they had to identify a symbol to represent those power words. And so that was pretty much what we did in the classroom. And from there, we created two-voice poetry, talking about, our project, by the way, was My Normal is Not Your Normal. And so we really wanted to focus on the fact that, you know, I might be a male, but I don't fit inside this box, and that's okay. And my normal is this, and your normal is this. And so their two-voice poems were, they were paired up with someone with the same identity trait, so male-female, or African-American-Asian, and they just talked about that element of their identity and how really, you know, we're different, but we still have this common thread. And from there, they went into the art room with Jackie, and they had to, and we'll get to the materials as well later on, I know, but they sifted through materials that she had to find symbols that went along with those identity traits and those power words. And then they created these dolls, these awesome, awesome dolls. And just every little piece that you see on there is some symbol representing those I am statements that they came up with in my classroom. And I think we'll talk about the challenges too, but it was, you know, we really wanted to focus on the repetition. Jackie wanted to focus a lot on the repetition as well. And, you know, I think that was probably one of the biggest challenges, is getting them to fill all that, you know, to fill that space and to use repetition. But, yeah, that's it.
Great. Sort of laying the context out of the, you know, the scope and the general summary of each of your projects. So to dive a little deeper, we have, you know, a series of questions that sort of talk about those larger you know, experiences with working with the materials, with working with found materials, with working with content, you know, and themes across classrooms. And some of the benefits and challenges of that process. So I think we just kind of have some questions that we're gonna go through, and we'll leave it kind of free and open-ended in terms of which of you maybe wanna respond to some questions more than others. But the first question that we have to the group is, how has learning about and engaging with outsider art impacted you personally as an educator throughout this process, using this process as a framework? Is there anyone who really felt an impact in terms of you personally as an educator, learning about either outsider art yourself or and then translating that to your students?
This is the first time that I have even heard of outsider art. And I know that there are several self-taught artists, I just didn't know that the title existed. So it was, I don't know, very exciting and intriguing to learn about this new thing, even though I've known that people are self-taught artists, just learning the title and then how detailed everything is. And looking at it from, I don't know, a perfectionist, school-taught artist perspective, and trying to go into the classroom and teach those things that I've learned in school to my students, it was kind of a relief to even know that this exists. So then they can feel more free, because I think that they are pretty much self-taught artists. Like, a lot of them, even by the time that they've gotten to high school, might not have had any art classes at all. Yeah. So they're coming in new, and they think that they're supposed to create something 100% perfect or exactly how it looks, and that's not how it is. So once we teach them about, you know, the elements of art or the principles of design, and they can put those things together but come up with something that they taught themselves to do, I think it's kind of an incredible thing. So it was a really great experience for me.
Great, great. Yeah. Any other thoughts from any other panelists? Personal learnings or impacts?
I think for myself, I've always been a huge fan of outside art, but it was something that I was always timid about bringing into my classroom. And I think especially with teaching elementary school, I was a little apprehensive of, like, can my students comprehend and understand this? And I'm really glad that I did, because they just jumped at the notion of, like, that they're untrained artists, and they're making connections even today regarding it. We just watched a video a few days ago about, like, Debruca, and they're like, and we were inspired by untrained artists. They're like, outsider artists! And they were so excited. But I think, again, a lot of my students also made that connection too, that, like, I am not necessarily super trained, and I think sometimes, especially around the middle years, the kids get really judgmental of their own artwork. So I think seeing artists who are really, like, open and free and are not obsessed with perspective or very specific, highly detailed and highly realistic looking artwork was really approachable and exciting for them.
And to piggyback off on that, I think another element of that more for my seventh graders, definitely the, you know, just not having to be perfect, and I think that's huge, but also the fact that so many of these artists themselves dealt with mental health and many issues, and to see the way they use their art as a way to heal was so important. And I feel that that's a big takeaway for me and my students, to just feel you don't have to be perfect, just find that way to express yourself, and it's such a healing process to be able to create.
Mm-hmm. And that room for experimentation, especially with materials, you know, I think several of you probably were working with materials with your students that they hadn't necessarily worked with before, or you haven't worked with them together before, so that room and that kind of co-experience of experimenting together.
And discovery.
Yeah, which is really important.
Let's just throw this one out. How has this experience of using outsider art in the classroom affected your approach to lesson planning and or arts integration? Are you going to use it again?
So I'll say I moved to seventh grade. This is my fourth year. I was the third grade teacher forever and ever. And, you know, just diving into that and to top that off, we have a very strong arts program at our school with Jackie. We have a great music program. We're really lucky that way, and we have an amazing organization that fundraises for the arts. And so we're very fortunate in that we have a lot of residency programs for arts integration and all this stuff at our school. It's wonderful. But when I moved to seventh grade, when I was in third grade, I integrated all the time. I don't know if it was just easier because I was self-contained. It just became something that I lost almost, and it seemed hard learning a new curriculum and all of that. So really, it just renewed my spirit for the arts, and just being able to find a new way to bring it back into the classroom is huge for me personally. So yes,
right.
And I can't imagine not doing it. It was the push I needed in the right direction to get back at it.
That's great to hear, and I realize that on the panel represented, Jennifer is technically the only non-arts teacher, so it's good to hear your perspective of how it directly impacted you from the perspective of an ELA teacher. I guess for the remainder panelists that are arts teachers, I know that not all of your partner teachers are here, but any thoughts on that experience from your end as an art teacher integrating with a non-arts or a general grade level teacher?
I think it would be a great thing to begin the school year with, choosing an outside artist to go with our first unit. so then they can automatically see that, oh, I can do this. It's not something where they feel like, I can't do this, I'm not an artist, because that is what they say, coming mm-hmm. through the door. Right. And I'm always telling them, no, you are an artist. You have to claim it. And they don't want to, you know, because they're like, well, I can't do it exactly like that, but you give it your take and put all your energy into it. Mm-hmm. And I think that that's what outsider artists do, and that's a good example to show students, like, right at the beginning.
Mm-hmm. Do you think that's something that you would perhaps incorporate in the beginning of the school year in the future?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Art school is really small, so it's really easy to integrate. But having said that, also the students feel really comfortable in their classrooms and also didn't like integrating, say, if they had an issue with somebody else in another classroom. So we actually combined but then separated again for the ease of the student population. Using the outsider art was really easy with social studies, you know, just having a background onto the artist in the time period, what was happening in that time. It was a really smooth transition, I thought. It's really nice.
Okay. I know that...
Can I say something?
Oh, yeah.
I was in the Teacher Fellowship Program for 2 straight years. I still use a unit every year based on outsider art. Mm-hmm. And I'm telling you, it's the, I did the Sacred Towers with Mr. Imagination this year. 8th graders loved it. So it's something that you can use. The resources you use from now on, moving forward, it's going to be a great experience for you.
It's great to hear that you're still incorporating it. And I thought of you coming tonight because of the Susan King show, and I know you did a lesson around Susan King and juxtaposing cartoon characters.
Yeah.
So, good. Well, I hope that you feel comfortable with using the learnings from the program and the experience of incorporating outsider art, you know, arming you for this coming year in terms of how you might approach your curriculum now that you have this experience behind you. I know something that would be really great to touch on, and maybe some panelists can speak to this or have more insight than others, but in terms of just thinking of materials, if anyone would speak to sort of their experience with the materials or techniques, since outsider artists and the art that we were looking at for the Chicago Calling Exhibition and other artists often incorporate upcycled, found objects, non-traditional art materials, non-traditional techniques. Not maybe some of you, like I said earlier, were using tools. I know in Jan's classroom they were using saws and cutting tools at a very young age. So if anyone has any insights or experiences into their learnings or their experiences with these materials that were maybe new for you or new for your classroom.
And I would just like to say that none of the teachers that aren't even here use the word trash, because I have this feeling, if you stand up in front of your class and say, we're going to make art out of trash, you turn the students off immediately, because it's trash. How are you going to make something nice out of trash, you know? And you just approach it as materials, and you can tell by the work that's in the exhibit, the students just totally bought into it.
We actually, so I really like outsider art because of the resources that are available, you know, that you can use kind of anything. But we did take advantage of the stipend in a way. And I wanted to kind of use materials then that are kind of like blue collar, though, still, that you would work with in a factory or sorts. So I shopped on Uline and found things that like maybe you would also use if you worked. So I used to work and I would recycle a lot of the things that I used in the, like, a factory setting for artwork. So Uline helped me with the boxes and the heated shrink wrap, and even the kind of, it's not really a mass-produced thing, but like the magnifiers that you can find in like a Walgreens or that you see every day kind of from an older person's house, things like that.
Wait a minute.
So that was kind of like the what can we use? Oh, we also used, which only one student actually ended up using, was like a insulation foam, fireproofing foam, that we thought we could build things out of. And I don't know if you can picture, it's a bomb right there with the cave setting.
Mm-hmm.
then the other is just, you know, a lot of, I'm skipping on the word, but the board, you know.
Phone cord, right.
Mm-hmm. So things like that.
How did you broach the sensitive subject with your class? I don't think we all want to do Darger, but you did Darger, so how did you do that?
As students, you know, I don't know if it's creating, like, it starts with class culture of, like, we have a smaller setting, so it took about 2 days, you know, for them to actually really start to open up, a lot of pressing. But after a while, I definitely find that they really are into talking about experiences that are personal to them. Because it's really every day you'll see an impact, you know, somebody will be, like, crying or something, something happening. And it's hard to miss. So having a small setting made it a little easier, I believe. But we really just sat, I think we sat for a while. You know, we have a clock schedule, hour and a half classes, so we were able to sit and wait for somebody to kind of start speaking up, and then it just kind of rolled.
And are you referring to the penises and things
well,
like
that? Yeah, yeah.
Oh, that? Oh, yeah, yeah. You're talking about our story, like, too. But,
yeah.
It's like a blip, you know, like it wasn't much. We didn't really talk about it, we didn't like say like you're gonna speak penises, everybody, so be prepared. Just kinda happened. We do have 16 to 21 year olds, so maybe an older age group, but they don't act like an older age group, so I'm not sure.
Well, and to just stay with that thread for a second, can you offer some insight into how your students arrived at this collaborative sort of storytelling process that culminated with the material process?
Yeah. Right. So initially the story just kind of came to by people just speaking out about it's going to be like, who do we have, like a boy and a girl or a girl? And so it just developed in that sense of just writing down what the students were saying, like a popcorn, people just blurting out things, and then they die. Okay, now they're angels, and then they're going back to, and so it's just kind of students were, we did check that students, every student kind of had a say in it, so we were like, okay, we're missing from Zerah, so you need to speak up, you know, what do you think will happen here, Zerah? We'll go back to you, etc. And then once we had the story, kind of like just said who, you know, speak up, you want whatever section, whatever page of the book. And so they started calling out, and then the students said, don't talk, kind of got assigned one, etc.
The reason that I asked is because there are some very, so Darger's life and works, of course, invoke very heavy and challenging topics, but so did your students' story. And there are references to sexual trafficking and death and loss and danger and violence, so I think they harnessed some of those complexities of Darger into their own works.
Like probably 90% of 99 are based on like your emotion, like social emotional things. I haven't done one thing like, oh, this is Pablo Picasso, so let's learn him. They're all like kind of, what are you feeling?
Yeah. Rich, you have something to say?
Yeah, I just wondered if this now is the work of 12 different students.
It is.
And is this a selection of a larger body?
No, this was something that was created.
That's it.
This is it. So there was 2 students on 1 box, and then we did have 2 students who didn't complete their own box, who were having a lot of difficulty in class during the 3 weeks. So we did have that, but we originally were planned for like 16 boxes, I think, ended up with 12.
Can I just add, I think this is, you know, we've seen different approaches to how teachers teach Darger, and I feel like this is one of the stronger ones that I've seen, but because, too, it was a collaboration, it was a true collaboration between all the students, but that little added piece at the end of the magnifying glass, it really drew you in to get a closer look at what each scene had. What made you think to incorporate that?
That actually was really just, it didn't have any, like, we weren't like, oh, well, what kind of materials can we think of that we kind of come across things, and we were in the like Walgreens and like, oh, that's cool.
Which is how outsider artists think, right? Yeah. It's like whatever's readily available.
Right.
So I think you captured that.
At Walgreens.
Right. So yep. And that's kind of, you know, like you said, the non-traditional, you know, searching as an artist for what you want to use and things like that, that I try to use.
Did the students do the placements of the magnifying glasses?
They did.
Yeah?
Yep, they did. You know, we try to guide them in a way, like, what do you think is the most important part of your, and it was fairly easy with there being subjects, the boy and the girl. There is a couple that were a little, like, kind of off place and things like that, the room for creativity or, you know, other types of things. So it was up to them, for sure, and the size.
And we'd like to ask each one of the panelists, what was the biggest takeaway from the whole experience from September on? Don't say grueling.
A major learning, a biggest impact, personally or student-wise?
Yeah. I'll say I'm always looking for ways to have my students' work showcased and have their work being seen in front of an authentic audience. And the fact that they're creating this real work that's going to be exhibited in this amazing gallery space, and that it's not just for a grade, it's not, you know, it's not for the teacher to see, it's not even for my classmates in my school to see, I'm sharing it with the world. I mean, that's pretty impactful. So, I mean, everything we did here just goes very, very much with my mission to make sure to, you know, with everything I do, to try my best to make sure they have an authentic audience for their work. So thank you for that.
Thank you.
I think a sense of community. I mean, I focused our subject matter on areas of our community and having the students come together in that way, but I think also using materials. I am a 2D artist, and so moving into 3D art, especially with third graders, is like really wild sometimes, the thought of it. But I was like, we're gonna do this, we got all these crazy tools, we went through a lot. Melissa came to visit us on learning some of the tools. But even when my principal came in and observed, like close to the end of our project, and one of his takeaways was that the students were like, well, he's like, well, that's a really intense tool you're using. And they talked about how I trusted them and that they trusted themselves and they knew how to use them. And here's the process and here's this way. And I think it wasn't just about our writing and coming up with places and sharing in that way, but I think also just the art making process of feeling trusted and welcomed in a safe space was awesome. And everyone was so excited about it. And my older students came into class one day and saw them and like, why are we not using them? So now I have like all these spectacular tools thanks to the stipend, and like also what is really reasonable, but tools and, like are not. And,
Erin, it was so amazing with your colleague from the school who was really terrified to begin with. It was like, I know nothing about any of this. And she was so excited by the end of everything and at the opening. It was really wonderful to see that transformation.
Yeah, and that feeds off to the children too. Like, they were so excited.
Yeah. Great. That's great.
I think one of the biggest takeaways was learning how the students really felt about the community and how it's going to, what's going to happen within the next couple of years. Because we had them, I guess I didn't say this before, but like the title of our unit was Land Grab in the City. So we were talking about just gentrification and how this area is going to be built up. So finding out their opinions of what they think should be going on in the community. For the most part, everybody wants the Obama Library there. But then they're going to cut off Cornell Drive. So a lot of them talked about that. And it's going to stop, you know, people from getting from point A to B. And they wrote letters to the city, which didn't go to the city, but we had them write a letter to the city just to get their feelings out. And then in the end, to see that we talk about artists all the time in class, and sometimes I think it goes in one ear and out the other, but like from the pre-assessment to the post-assessment, they got it. Like, and so many of them really like Joseph Yocum. And I think because they can relate to his style better than Skeeless, even though we did use very like small paintbrushes, and they learned how to use a fan brush, so they were pretty happy about that. It was even a point where I had to be taken, like displaced from my classroom before the finish. So I had to go buy paint markers in order for them to finish it, because I was in the classroom without a sink, without windows. So
yes,
they still were able to, you know, complete the task, and they were really happy about it. I know at least one student told me that she came and she said the exhibit is amazing. Everything looks so great. Everybody's school did so well. Her and her mother came to see it a couple of weekends ago. So it just helped me to see that the things that they were talking about were real to them, and then they got a chance to see their work in a real art space.
That's great. Jordan?
Great.
What was the question?
Biggest takeaway, biggest impact, or learning, or kind of crystallizing moment?
You know, I don't know. Yeah, it was the students really, like, seeing the urgency from them once they realized that they have a connection with an artist who is established, who has had a movie made about them, who has done all these great things, who is not in a traditional sense an artist. And like seeing how they lit up a bit about that was really nice. So I definitely would be able to use this type of material in the future. And I think, yeah, that was great. They really enjoyed that connection.
Great.
And I would just like to ask, how did the students feel, Rhonda brought it up, when they saw the exhibit?
Yeah.
Ours?
All of them.
I didn't have any students come.
But other people did.
Yeah, I mean, it was a very proud moment for all of them to see. You know, I guess for ours, we did a couple different things. The totems, that was my homeroom. And it was, the other projects were, you know, similar ideas. Jenny can speak more about them. But, you know, the t-shirts, you know, they were only for selected. And so, you know, there was a bit of a bummer situation when, you know, they did that and they all wanted the, you know, their pieces at the gallery, of course. But they were so proud to bring their families, and
I mean, they were bragging.
Oh my
gosh.
Just
recently asking the ones that haven't been here, was my transparency up? And I was like, I don't know, did you come to a group that have never, ever in 8 years I've taught them shown any, like, any real genuine interest in, could care less if their work was shown anywhere, but because of the setting and the time spent, and we did three different kind of things going on in different groups, just that, like, the pride that they took, and, like, the kids were like, oh, no, your work was up there. So some kids
who... Well, pushed them harder in the classroom, too, because they knew how it was going to go down.
I definitely, like, I don't know, you might not make the cut. You got to bring it. What are you going to do? But it was kind of a cool...
We had a great showing. We had a good...
Yeah.
20?
This is my second time doing the fellowship. We had three times as many kids as last time we come through, so... That was really promising, but I think it definitely has that, like, rolling effect. Like, you do it again, then they even if you were to do it with, like, sixth graders, you did it with third grade, like, they now, like, you know, like, the seed's been planted.
Great.
Well, we would like to invite anyone to apply for next year's teacher fellowship program, and we're really excited that this summer we are partnering with the Kohler Arts Center, and we're doing an urban and rural art teacher retreat.
We're doing with a very select number of teachers that we hope to grow into an ongoing, expanded, more structured retreat program that we can market and really take applicants around. We're really excited to have this partnership, and
other institutions that work with teachers interested in our program and looking for ways to collaborate to support educators. On behalf of Intuit, we just want to say thank you to all of the educators in the room. Intuit loves teachers, and we really value the hard work and value your openness and willingness to incorporate this art and explore this art and expand the art history narrative to include these artists and to allow opportunities for your students to experiment and work with materials and techniques that they may not have been exposed to otherwise, and to learn about artists and individuals that reflect where who they are and where they come from.
And we almost have the whole board on board.
Yes. So with that, I think we'll wind down our conversation. Of course, we could keep this going, and there's a lot more to talk about, but we encourage you to talk amongst yourselves or to keep the conversation going. The exhibition is on view through Sunday, so please spend time with it tonight, come back over the weekend. If you don't follow the Intuit Educator Network on Facebook, that is a great and growing way to stay engaged with other teachers. We've been posting about the art on view in the show. We encourage teachers to join that and post photos of what they're doing in their classrooms. So there are ways to keep this conversation going besides just here right now. And if there are any educators interested in speaking to Jerry and I about possibilities for participating with Intuit at the Illinois Art Education Association Conference, and speaking about using outside art in the classroom, we would love to speak with you. The deadline to submit any proposal is Saturday. So if anyone is hot to get on a quick partnership.
And it's close. It's in St. Charles. It's not far.
Yeah, we would love to. Intuit has done a presentation every year for these past few years, but we would love to have teachers speaking on behalf of the program rather than just Intuit staff.
And you can get a room for $50 a night.
Jerry's selling
it.
Thank you, panelists, for being so open and willing to talk about your work this year.
Thank you.
Have some more food, grab some more drinks, take some giveaways. We'll still be here. I know this is slated to end at 7, but I'll still be here. So hang around for a little while. Have another drink. Let's talk. And we appreciate you, and thank you so much for coming tonight.